if we speak about the follow-up of either patient, we have to speak about what is the normal aorta. We have to think about how much contrast is necessary. What are good indications for the EVA therapy and how to proceed with EVA? And of course, we have to speak about how to follow up these EVA patients. So, is there any need for every patient to use convalescent ultrasound? If we start by fundamental examination of the aorta, we see pretty good the aorta movement here. We see the IVC, we see the mesenteric artery. We also use the longitudinal view in the conventional grayscale. We see, don't see any major pathology. But of course, we can also use color Doppler to see, is there any major pathology? So we see that the aorta is nearly filled with contrast, some aliasing due to the systolic and diastolic movement of the heart. And also in the longitudinal view, we don't see any flaps, looks pretty good. And also if you look at the pulse wave Doppler, we see that the curve is pretty nice, no major noise in this curve. But if we find any pathology, we have to decide how much contrast is necessary. Of course, less contrast is better because it's a major vessel. So if we decide, depending on the system, between 1.0 cc of contrast followed by 10 cc of saline. Depending on the system, sometimes we need a bit more, that means 1.2, but don't inject a complete half of vial of contrast. If we speak about aortic dissection, we know that an aortic aneurysm will be called an aortic aneurysm if the diameter is more than 3 centimeters. We also know that in the vessel nation, we have got a higher risk to develop an aortic aneurysm. And we know that more than 60% of these aneurysms are asymptomatic. In the case this patient has got pain, it's just at the moment probably the aneurysm rupture. And we know also that there is a correlation between the diameter and the risk of rupture. So that means if you have got a bigger diameter of the aneurysm, the risk that the rupture will be more in comparison to less. So in this slide, I will show you and compare the kind of all tools. So we have quantum and the grayscale, we have the color Doppler, and on the other side, we have the contrast enhanced ultrasound image. So we have some problem with the color Doppler due to pulsation. We have these overriding artifacts. If we compare this to the conventional contrast enhanced ultrasound, we can clearly see the thrombotic change at the wall. We can see the lumen inside filled with contrast. No extravasation, so a normal aortic aneurysm. The same information also in the longitudinal view. We precipitate define the grayscale aneurysm. Then we see here this kind of summarized mode. We see define the shape of the aneurysm. We see the contrast stays in and can exclude a rupture of this aneurysm. With color Doppler, we of course see the same information, but with less information. Less mean due to pulsation with this overriding artifact. And if I have to answer if there's any ulceration, probably it's pretty hard to see in this image. If we speak about other dissection, we know often that we see the flap move in the grayscale, but that happens not every time. If we want to follow up this patient, we want to know if both lumen have got flow inside or one is thrombus, and where are the entire from the renal artery. So the easy case is if you have this kind of aortic dissection. You see the movement of the flap in the axial view, also in the longitudinal view, and if you see how fast these flaps move to the skin, you see probably that's a true lumen, that's a false lumen. Of course, in the next step, we can use the color Doppler setting, and we see that there's a different kind of flow direction, because here most of the lumen is coded in red. Here is colored in blue, so there seem to be different kind of flows. But where I find more information by using this tool? So if we start again with an axial view, we have side-by-side technique. In the most case, contrast arrives in the true lumen, so that's the true lumen. Here is a false lumen. This is the right renal artery. And also here in the longitudinal view, we see the true lumen, the false lumen, and the right renal artery. The left renal artery is not visible in this patient because this patient has got only one kidney. But in the meantime, you have enough time after monitoring the dissection to use the time and look at the right kidney. So if we look at the right kidney, we see pretty fine. There's a lot of contrast arrived. We see no major infarction in comparison to part of the liver, which appears here on the left side of the image. And if we compare this now to the CTA, we see pretty fine the dissection. We see pretty fine the false lumen, and we see that the right renal artery entered from the false lumen, and this patient has got only one kidney. But this patient had no major renal failure, so it works pretty good with the blood supply of this kidney. This is a much not so easy case. If we start looking very carefully at the grayscale image and look very carefully at the color image, the question is there any dissection? If you look carefully at the color setting, you see there might be something here because there's a shift in the color. But this could be also an artifact. Of course, we can say, okay, we use a more higher frequency probe. Maybe we can get rid of these problems. So I use now a 9 megahertz probe. Is it helpful? Take your time, look carefully at this image. This patient had got pain, abdominal pain. Might be a dissection, might be something else. Probably it's very clear that we are not seeing a good dissection membrane as we've seen it before. So we will now see what happens if we inject contrast. Same patient, same probe, pretty fine. Everybody see it now, the dissection in the axial plane, and we see also the flap here moving here in the longitudinal view. So there is more information which often are very difficult to see. So is there a suspicion of an aortic dissection? I can only recommend, if you don't see it in grayscale, just inject a couple of milliliters of contrast and probably we see major pathologies. Another case. So we have seen the celiac trunk. We see some elising here. Is this a high degree of stenosis? Or could it be a dissection of the entire celiac trunk? I think it's pretty hard to answer this question by using these two images. So Eddie has shown fantastic images from the image fusion. And I'm honest, I told you this patient had already dissection. So we see this long dissection here in the aortic aorta and also toric aorta in the longitudinal view. So this tool could be used to follow up this patient. So if we now do this kind of fusion, we see here the celiac trunk and we see the dissection membrane enter the celiac trunk. Same information we see it with the contrast enhanced ultrasound. And what about the right renal artery? And if we compare the image fusion with the CT and the contrast ultrasound, it's pretty similar. But what is new? There is a second entry. And this wasn't seen in CT. So we give additional information. If we speak about covered rupture, we know that sometimes they've got a hematoma. But the problem is, did we really catch the pathology? Starting with conventional grayscale image, we see a kind of hematoma here. We look at color Doppler, we see the flow inside of the aortic lumen. We see some flow next to the aortic lumen, so there might be an aneurysm. And if we inject now contrast, you see pretty fine, that's the right renal artery, that's the original lumen of the aorta. Here's a covered rupture, here's an hematoma. And we can detect small bubbles entered from the lumen in the wall. So that's an active bleeding in the wall. See the bubbles entered from the lumen. And the next question you have to answer, because the surgery will ask you immediately after the report, where is the left renal artery? Because this patient will be often treated with an aortic stent graft. So if there's not enough space between the covered rupture and the renal arteries, you need either a special custom-made stent graft or you need an open therapy. And again, covered rupture, IVC, right renal artery, left renal artery. So the covered rupture is very close to both renal arteries. And if you compare this now to the CT examination, you see that was a rupture we've seen. That's the left renal artery, right renal artery. Same information is available also on CT as we've seen it before. This patient was sent to our department because of pain. And I was really get a little bit afraid when I see this kind of plug which moved in the lumen. And if you look carefully, it's also kind of rupture here. And it's just part of the plug floating in the lumen. That is, you see the movement. There's a part of ulceration here. And if you want to know, is it really kind of ulceration? We see the movement of this flap in the lumen. And also here, you see that this flap and the ulceration is filled with contrast. So a high risk for the patient that this flap will rupture and move forward to the iliac arteries. We look at the CT examination. It was only seen on one slide here. And the treatment for this patient was an aortic stent graft immediately after this diagnosis. Sometimes we have also a chance to look at the thoracic aorta. So in this case, we use an abdominal probe. We see a kind of hematoma here. We see that the patient has a huge thoracic aneurysm. We see it in color Doppler. And the question is it a rupture or an active bleeding? So we inject contrast, take a while, see a huge thoracic aneurysm. And here you see a rupture. It's just covered by the hematoma. Also, this patient go immediately in the emergency room and receive an aortic stent graft afterwards. So that's an active bleeding here. And only covered by the rupture. This was a CT afterwards. You see the patient received his stent graft, and you see the huge aneurysm, aortic aneurysm, and the rupture, and the active bleeding. A special case of an aortic rupture is a fistula between the aorta and the IVC. Often we find the same sign as we find this fistula sign in the femoral arteries. You see this kind of elising, so we suspicion of a fistula. But the question is, will we receive more information if we use now contrast? So we inject contrast. We see the aortic lumen getting filled. So one channel here. The second channel here. So it's not one fistula, it's two fistulas. Again, in the dynamic MRA, that the aorta is filled with contrast, an aortic aneurysm, an aneurysm of the iliac arteries, we see that the vein of the femoral veins and the iliac veins are missing, but still contrast in the IVC. The only explanation why we see this contrast is due to a fistula from the aorta to the IVC in this part of the area. This also was confirmed by the CTA. We see the iliac arteries here, and we see the aorta and the IVC filled with contrast. And in this area is a fistula. But CT and MRI only describe one fistula. But intraoperative, we find two, and was confirmed also by contrast and ultrasound. Inflammatory aneurysms are a rare case. The first was described by Walker in the year 1972. Often we find a thickness of the lateral and the ventral part of the aortic wall. And if we use contrast, probably we see the contrast uptake as a sign of the inflammatory reaction. So this patient had got an inflammatory aneurysm. This was already treated with an aortic stent graft. We see the stent graft inside. We see the thickness of the ventral part of the wall and the lateral part of the wall. And the question is our conventional rule sensitive enough to detect flow of the wall here? We see the same information CT, stent graft, that's the thickness of the wall. We use the color Doppler settings. We couldn't see major vessels, even small vessels we couldn't detect. So if we inject contrast, we see that the nice filling of the stent graft. And then we see a lot of contrast uptake on the ventral part of the aortic wall, of the lateral part of the aortic wall. On the dorsal part, often we don't see any contrast uptake because inflammatory aneurysm have a thickness of the lateral part and of the ventral part of the aorta. And also on the longitudinal view, here we see the stent graft, and we see the contrast uptake of the aortic wall, and we can use this tool for monitoring for or treatment. So if this is a successful treatment, the contrast uptake over time will be less in the follow-up. And if you place this kind of quantification software, as we already seen, we can monitor your success of treatment. So what about endovascular repair? There are two kind of studies. Which one is called the DREAM study, one was called the British EVA study, and they compare open surgery in comparison to endovascular repair. And the result is that there's no major difference at the beginning. We had some patient where this patient got diameter aneurysm with about 4 centimeters. In the follow-up, 3 years later, the aneurysm was 3 centimeters bigger, so I mean nearly 7 centimeters. The problem was that the function of the renal function was not good. So an elevated creatinine. And the problem is, if you would like to place an aortic stent graft in this patient, you need normal urate contrast. But you have got a high risk to ruin the function of this patient. So we decide for the first time that we try to do this by contrast and ultrasound and only fluoroscopy. So I bring it just in the operation theater. So we see. Then we push the stent graft through the aortic aneurysm here. Of course, we have do preliminary roadshow. So I mean, one day early, we check if we can see every major landmarks. The landmarks mean where are the renal arteries, how long is the distance of the aneurysm neck. So here we see the renal artery, and this distance is about 3 centimeters. So that's the landing place for the stent graft. Then we implant the stent graft. We see the stent graft is now open. We is connected with both legs of the stent graft. But we see also pretty fine that some bubbles appear here. And if you wait a little bit more, we see a lot of bubbles appear here. So that means this patient has got an endoleak. Endoleak 1B means that tired from the distal part of the iliac artery and tired in this way to the aneurysm. So successful treatment in this patient is just use a balloon catheter and do dilatation again. So we do this. We have, of course, to follow up again. And in the follow-up, we see in the axial view, the both legs of the stent graft, the major body of the stent graft. And also in the long view, we see the iliac part of the stent graft and the endoleak doesn't appear. So that was a successful treatment. And this patient was the first patient we treated in this way. That was in the year 2007 and published 2008. In the meantime, we do more patients and we compare our studies in comparison to conventional EVA and EVA with the help of convalescent ultrasound. So we compare 15 patients with this kind of mixed procedure in comparison to the standard procedure. And if we look at our results, of course, we need a little bit more time at the beginning because we use only half of the contrast volume. 3 patients was done without any urate contrast, and we detect more endoleaks, and we can do immediately a reintervention in the operation room. So this is more success for this patient. But if you implant now an aortic stent graft, you have to think about follow-up. Follow-up means this patient needs a lifetime follow-up. So we look at the axial plane, we see the filling of the stent graft, we see the aortic aneurysm here. We look for any kind of endoleaks. And we also look in the longitudinal plane. We see the main part of the stent graft, that's the iliac legs here. Also here, no endoleak appear. And at the end of the day, we have also to measure the diameter, because if it's a successful treatment, the diameter should be less in the follow-up. If it doesn't, is not less in the follow-up, you have to think about an endoleak. If you speak about complication with these kind of stent graft, think about in the early period, hematoma or seroma or infection or even endoleaks appear. In the late period, often we find endoleaks or occlusion or sometimes dislocation. Dislocation probably are very hard to see by ultrasound, therefore we use an explain conventional X-ray technique. If you look for the classification of endoleaks, what kind of endoleaks could appear? That means type 1 means that the entire is from the head of the stent graft, from the neck, between the aortic wall and the stent graft. 1B means from the distal part, same direction. The most common endoleaks are the type 2 endoleaks. Either it's a lumbar artery as a feeding vessel or the inframesenteric artery. Type 3 means there's a hole in the stent graft or a disconnection between one of the iliac stents here. So contrast will immediately appear in the aneurysm sac if you inject contrast. Now I have a couple of cases where we can look if we find any endoleak. So starting with conventional grayscale image, we see predefined the stent graft inside. With color copper, we see here there is a flow in the stent graft. But this technique is not as sensitive as contrast and ultrasound. Therefore, we could not exclude any endoleak here. This patient also had got a CT examination, and I give you the axial plane and also the coronal plane. We described that we couldn't see any endoleak, and the follow-up was 2 days later with contrast and ultrasound. So I give you the longitudinal plane, and you can look carefully if you find any endoleak. Probably you see some contrast appears here, should not be there, and you have got a long window for do the examination, and you see some contrast arrived here and here. So that means this patient has got an endoleak type 1A and type 1B. We summarize it, we see again contrast appears here and also on the distal part. Why CT hasn't seen this? It's very easy to explain. They do a good work, but the timing was not perfect. You never know when the contrast arrived, and if you're out of this range of the time, you don't see it because it hasn't the time to fill it inside. Again, see contrast next to the stent graft, so the patient got a type 1A and type 1B endoleak. Again, in an aortic stent graft, you see that the stent graft, that the aortic aneurysm, we see it's nice filled with color Doppler. Color Doppler, no endoleaks appear, even if we have optimized the pulse obstruction frequency. And of course, if we look at this window, probably everybody would say, I would like to have a more bony window in order to detect kind of endoleaks and can compare whether it's calcification or contrast. So if we optimize the window, most of us will see this calcification here, but here it's not as wide as the calcification, so suspicion of an endoleak. Now, if we inject contrast, we see a nice filling of the stent graft, and we wait a little bit, then we see here the inframesenteric artery is a feeding vessel in this case. Also, if we choose another position of the probe, in the longitudinal way, we see the inframesenteric artery here as a feeding vessel, and also in the axial plane. And you see how much contrast arrived in this aortic aneurysm. So that's in type 2A endoleak. Another patient, starting with a grayscale examination, aneurysm with a diameter about 5 centimeters. Color probably has some artifacts here due to the gas. If we look carefully at the contrast and ultrasound, we see the filling of the stent graft, and it looks at this area here. The first bubbles appear there. And we wait a little bit, and wait, and we see it take a time since the bubbles arrived, but that's a type 2 endoleak over the lumbar artery. What happens if you think you have seen an endoleak and the CT department said, we don't believe you? This happens often, so the only solution to get rid of this is this kind of, Eddie already shown you, this kind of image fusion. So if you have this kind of image fusion and see side by side the movement of the T hand, the contrast and ultrasound, there's no excuse that there's no endoleak. So in this patient, we do the examination with the grayscale. We see the filling of the stent graft. We couldn't detect any endoleak. I give you also the CT examination. You can build your own mind if there's any endoleak, because CT described there is no endoleak. Then we do this kind of fusion imaging technique. So we fusion the grayscale with the CT and also with the color. We couldn't detect any endoleak. And now we use the contrast and ultrasound examination. So we wait. You see the breathing of the patient, also the movement. If you look at this area, bubbles appear there. So it's an endoleak over the mesenteric artery. And if we show this image to our colleague from the CT department, and they have more information now where to look and where should the endoleak appear, often they find it retrospective. So in this case, they agree that there's an endoleak, which I haven't seen in CT. So if we summarize now, these technique helps to detect aortic disorders like dissection or covered rupture or inflammatory aneurysm, but also is helpful for detection of endoleaks, and we can do pretty good classification of endoleaks. We have also additional information, for example, if you think about real and false lumen, think about the dissection and about the perfusion of the kidney or of the liver that is in one day shopping. And also we know that contrast ultrasound is more specific than CT in the evaluation and classification of endoleaks in the abdominal aorta. In difficult case, image fusion could be a helpful tool to explain where is the pathology and to use these technique to monitor your patient, for example, if a difficult patient, and the follow-up. Thank you much for your attention.